and it's nothing like I've ever known before. Love is an open door. Love is an open door.
Quick and creepy. That's how I like these intros. Let me guess, you've just won a free coffin. Congratulations! But it's second hand, so there's already someone inside. Gutted. Well, probably not, unless it was a sarcophagus. But obviously, you've decided to open it up, and you're a little anxious. And I don't blame you, right? You don't know what to expect. What will it smell like? What will it look like? And of course, that journey has led you here to this video, because why else would you be watching a video on this? But do not fear, you are in the right place, and I am here to provide you with some much-needed answers. I've tried to unearth as much information as possible to try and get as wide an answer as possible. To be honest, it does depend on a few different factors, like how the body was treated before it was put into the coffin, how long it's been in the coffin decomposing for, and where the coffin has been put, to name but a few. But taking this all into account, it's time for a guided tour of what you will experience when you inevitably open a coffin, or a casket, which I think is the more common word in the United States. Let me know. Firstly, what would it smell like? As soon as you open the coffin, the first thing that's probably going to hit you is the smell. You may also disturb a few flies that have got in there and made it their home, but the smell will be the most overpowering thing. There are a few different chemicals that give a dead body its characteristic smell, and to avoid me repeatedly saying science word again and again, just think of them collectively as science smells. Surprisingly, they're not only found in death, and so we can relate the pungent corpse smell to things we might experience in real life. It's officially hashtag relatable content, even though we all die. So actually, maybe death is one of the ultimate hashtag relatable content. You've cracked the code, Sophie. The YouTube code. They'll give you an award any day now. The perfume of the coffin, or le parfum de cercueil, if you will, is made up of cadaverine and putrescine. These tasty sounding chemicals provide a je ne sais quoi, and by that I mean a characteristic rotting flesh smell. But don't worry, they can be found in real life because they can give you bad breath, they're in your urine, and also, you may be surprised to hear, in semen. The temptation to call this video Semen Smells Like Dead Bodies was almost overpowering, much like the smell of cadaverine and putrescine. Our next ingredient and science smell is scatol. That is what Google says the pronunciation is. This old friend also contributes to bad breath and is found in your poo. Mm. Next up is indole, which is also found in your feces. It's a common ingredient in jasmine oil and apparently is used to flavour some ice creams. I know, although that makes perfect sense, let me explain. You see, at low concentrations, indole actually has like a flowery, perfumed scent. Here's a description from like the official chemical analysis I found of it online. Almost floral odour when highly purified, otherwise exhibits characteristic odour of feces. I feel like the all caps approach represents my bewilderment quite well. So those are some of the chemicals released when your tissues are decomposing. And of course I mean a tissue as in a collection of cells, not one of these. But if those smells being generated by your body weren't enough, then bacteria add more into the mix. When we're alive, our bodies are full of bacteria. We have trillions of them inside us. Now, trillions is a big old word, so let's put that into a bit of context. You may have more bacterial cells in your body than you do human cells. This isn't always technically true. I've heard that fact kind of batted around quite a lot, so I did a bit more research into it, and it turns out that the numbers can vary a lot from person to person, and even depending on how much bacteria you've pooped out recently. But the point is that they are very similar. It means you've got a lot of bacteria in you, especially in your gut. And so when you die, they kind of spill out and take over everywhere. Certain types of bacteria, as they react with chemicals in your body, produce gases, namely science smells, hydrogen sulfide, ammonia, and methane. Hydrogen sulfide, infamously, smells like rotten eggs. Ammonia has a really strong chemical smell and it's associated with urine. Methane, surprisingly, doesn't actually smell like anything at all, so I guess it can go off the science smells list. If you've used methane in something like Bunsen burners in a school lab and you think it does smell, it's because it often has chemicals added to it to make it smell for safety reasons, so you can like sniff out if there's a gas leak or something. Before the days of coffins, these gases would just leak out into the world. But as coffin technology advanced, some were created with tight seals. And these were advertised as protecting the body from the outside elements. While this does slow down decomposition in some ways, it's things that were in your body already, like bacteria and enzymes, that trigger a lot of the breakdown processes. So this means that the gases and the smells are still being produced, but because the coffin has a tight seal, then there's not much chance for them to escape. So opening up a tightly sealed and still intact coffin would be quite the experience. And I say still intact because sometimes the gas pressure in these coffins is so great that it actually pops them open. To counteract this tightly sealed coffin issue, another type of coffin, known as a burping coffin, was created, and this basically allows some gas to escape whilst also having a tight enough seal that it does partly protect the body from the outside elements. Also, while we're on the topic of protecting the body, then the process of embalming also slows down the rate of decomposition, and so an embalmed body would also probably take longer until it started smelling. There are different types of embalming, but common practices include replacing all the blood from the body with a special fluid that like fixes, or I guess like freezes your cells in place, and also emptying out the body of any remaining urine or feces that were still in it. These methods can prevent the cells from breaking down as quickly as they would normally, and also reduce the amount and spread of bacteria in your body. So if you're opening the coffin of a recently embalmed corpse, it's probably going to be a great deal fresher than the same corpse if it hadn't been embalmed. An embalmed corpse will eventually decompose, it just takes a bit longer. And that time, again, depends on all sorts. The type of embalming it underwent, the type of casket it's been left in, how wet or dry the situation it is in is. But ultimately, if you open a coffin, it will smell. Are we enjoying this? I hope so, because up next, we've got sight. All right, so you've opened up that coffin you won, remember, and the smell has gone past you and it's subsided and it's all fine. So you now are gonna take a look inside, and what are you going to see? Well, a dead body, that's obvious, but what is that dead body gonna look like? Well, you know, it depends on how long the dead body's been there, but let me give you some thoughts. Was that the least smooth intro I've ever done? One of the first changes that happens when someone dies is that all of their blood settles to the bottom of their body. So if they were lying on their back, it's all gonna settle along like their back and their bum, the back of their thighs and their ankles and so on. This happens because without your heart pumping to keep the pressure up, your blood is just gonna succumb to the force of gravity and this means that those areas where it settles end up looking darker and more bruised, and everywhere else ends up looking paler. After a few hours, the liver and gallbladder, amongst other tissues, will start to be broken down. Now, the reason I mention these two in particular is because they contain a yellowy liquid known as bile. When this bile seeps out, it then gives your skin a more yellowy tinge. Over the next couple of days, the bacteria I mentioned earlier start to take over, and that hydrogen sulfide that I mentioned that some of them release can also contribute to making you look more yellow, or at least look more waxy. Although perhaps obvious to say, this yellowiness will be more noticeable if you have a pale skin tone, so I would basically look like a Simpson. Some bacteria also react with the hemoglobin in your blood to produce sulfur hemoglobin. This gives you like a marbled greeny black appearance, and the reason it's marbled is because it's in your blood vessels, and so it'll come out where your blood vessels are. As the months go by, the body will end up changing colour again. By now, any blood will have seeped out of the disintegrating vessels that once held it, and the iron in the blood will react with oxygen to essentially turn to rust, making your body look darker than it was before. So the body you unearth could be anywhere within that colour spectrum, like a morbid chameleon. That is, if it's still fresh enough to have skin. And if it does still have skin, then it's probably going to be super bloated too, from all those bacteria releasing all those gases that I mentioned earlier. And it'll probably also have some blisters and loose skin coming off. And seeing as your cells contain a lot of water and during decay your cells are bursting open, then decomposition is a pretty soggy affair. So looking at a corpse, if the water hasn't evaporated, it probably has quite the wet sheen to it. And here are some other things you might see. If the body's about 40 to 50 years old, it's probably not going to have flesh anymore. If it was in a wet place, then there might be a waxy substance near where the bum and thighs once were. This is because there's a chance that the dense fat in those areas might react to form something called grave wax. On the other hand, if the body was in a dry place, then there's a chance it could have started to undergo natural mummification. This would begin with tight leathery black skin forming first around places where skin was thinner, so kind of around the scalp, but after a certain amount of time, if the situations are right, then all the skin could become mummified. In any case though, whether wet or dry, eventually the skin and tendons will disintegrate, leaving only the bones. And if it's been hundreds of years, then maybe the bones will have disintegrated too, from the inside out. Your teeth are actually what last longest, so that's something to smile about. Let's wind this up, it's time to conclude. What you see and smell when you open up a coffin will depend on many different factors. Was the body embalmed or not? Was it left in a wet or dry place? How long has it been decomposing for? Casper's law states that a body left out in open air will decompose twice as fast as one that isn't. So, if the body is embalmed, sealed tightly, but not so tightly that no gas can escape, and you come across it relatively soon after it's been buried, then, perhaps unsurprisingly, it may look eerily fresh. But in general, it'll smell all sorts of ways, look all sorts of ways, and leave you feeling all sorts of ways. This video topic was suggested to me by a friend, and I agreed it could be quite interesting. Like, it's a topic that makes a lot of us squirm, and I certainly had some uncomfortable moments doing the research, and not just when semen came up. But I found out some unexpected fun facts along the way, and so I hope you enjoyed it too. And there are some death positivity movements out there that encourage us all to talk about death more and look at it in a slightly different way. And this making this video has kind of made me think, oh, I should look at those more. So that's a little note to self. It's a bit self-indulgent because it's not a note to self, it's a note to all of you as well. So there, take my note. It's Soph's notes. So notes to Soph, notes to self. I could do something there, but I probably won't. Also, in the weird in-between where I'd written the script and needed to film, but I also did a little quick Google, I came across the YouTube channel Ask a Mortician, I'll put it this side actually, which is a YouTube channel where death is discussed in a really informative and interesting, and to be honest, properly funny way. And Caitlin, who's the presenter, is also quite big in the death positivity movement world. So if you found this video interesting, there is tons more to look at. I will link it below. But that is it for now. Like this video if you like it, share it if you share it, subscribe it if you subscribe it, and comment if you have a comment about anything like this. Are you scared of death? Is that, no, don't comment that. Or if you want to, you can. Is that too much? You decide, or just comment how you feel about winning a coffin. That's a bit more fun. Oh, I'm gonna stop. All that's left to say is thank you so much for watching, have a lovely day, and congratulations once more on that coffin that you mysteriously won. Here's a summary, everyone. Pause it and read it, if you wanna do that. I am on my way to the outtakes. Hopefully I'll get there just before you do, so I can quickly make them. Right, let's do this. Let us do this. With a bit of lippy, it's a little bit rare. Pushing the boat out for a video about corpses. I've just basically sprayed this in my mouth. Funnily enough, protecting the body from the outside elements. Bad American accent. Don't do an American accent when most of your watchers are from the States. You got a fast horse, I got a ticket to being dead. Maybe we can make a deal, but maybe that's how I ended up dead. Nobody asked why I'm dead. Oh, no. Let's wind this up. It's time. Oh, sorry. It's time to get some manners. Not even worth the outtakes, to be honest.